Stardate 41153.7. 78 years have passed since the days when the original crew of the USS Enterprise explored the unknown wonders of the universe. Now, a spectacular new galaxy starship, 8 times larger and light years ahead in technology, has been designed. Its mission: to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and civilizations, to boldly go where none have gone before. The all-new adventures of Star Trek: The Next Generation, with an all-new crew specifically selected to serve on board the most technologically advanced starship ever built. Their primary function: to gain further understanding of the universe and their place in it. In command is Jean-Luc Picard, Starfleet captain, and one of the Federation's most distinguished leaders.
Stand by.
Ready for departure, sir.
Engage. We have a long voyage ahead of us.
Commander William Riker. He's executive in charge of away missions and second in command.
I have no problem with following any rules you lay down, short of compromising your safety.
One further thing.
Anything, sir.
I'm not a family man, Riker. And yet, Starfleet has given me a ship with children aboard. But since a captain needs an image of geniality, you're to see that's what I project.
Aye, sir.
Welcome to the Enterprise, Commander Riker.
Joining them on the crew is Lieutenant Commander Data, an android with amazing memory and strength. Counselor Deanna Troi, a half-human, half-betazoid with incredible psychic powers.
I'm sensing a powerful mind.
Lieutenant Geordi LaForge, blinded since birth, wears a unique visual device to see beyond ordinary humans.
How are you examining them, Geordi?
In every way, microscopically, thermally, electromagnetically.
Tasha Yar, security chief and refugee from a renegade planet, fighting for justice. The former enemy of the Federation, Klingon Lieutenant Worf, now serves aboard the Enterprise. Chief Medical Officer Beverly Crusher. It was Picard who ordered her husband on his ill-fated mission. She is joined by her brilliant son, Wesley. Now, the classic legend that changed the face of television forever lives on in Star Trek: The Next Generation. This is Paramount Studios in Hollywood, where production is currently underway on the latest episode of Gene Roddenberry's new space odyssey, Star Trek: The Next Generation.
The way Paramount interested me in this one, they said it's impossible to do again, at which point my ears perked up.
No television series has ever been able to claim the legendary fame that Star Trek has, a statistic Patrick Stewart found rather awesome when auditioning for the role of Captain Jean-Luc Picard.
When this first became a possibility, a good friend of mine here in Los Angeles said, this was, I think, just before my final meeting for the role, how does it feel to be auditioning for an American icon? And I think that remark unnerved me more than anything else that had been said about it at the time, because although I'd seen a lot of Star Trek in the 60s and early 70s, I still had no comprehension of how much a part of American culture this series had become and how many millions of people had been influenced by it.
You will now answer to the charge of being a grievously savage race.
Grievously savage could mean anything. I will answer only specific charges.
There are a lot of issues and challenges in the 80s and 90s and the end of the century that need talking about. And they need talking about in drama, because drama will move people, will cause people to think, and much more than any straight show.
Robert Justman and Richard Berman are supervising producers. For Robert, working on the new series is like deja vu. Between 1966 and 1969, he co-produced the original Star Trek with Gene Roddenberry, an experience he remembers fondly.
It's like I went home one night in 1968 and came back to work the next morning in 1986. That's what it's like. It's like time passed in a wink of an eye, and nothing has changed, and the feeling between us has only grown. We're closer and more emotionally bound to each other than we ever were. And so it's a wonderful feeling.
As the premiere of the series approaches, there's a feeling of excitement and anticipation around the set. The cast have a tough act to follow, and they realize this.
To a long and successful voyage, the new crew of the Enterprise.
Live long and prosper.
We've had, I must say, very positive response. We received letters already welcoming us to the Star Trek family, as it were. And I'm under the impression that by virtue of being Star Trek fans, they are for the future and for progress. And this certainly is an expression of that. And I hope that we will be received accordingly and not judged as trying to replace someone.
It's not a remake of a television legend. It is totally a new series, a new concept.
Sir, respectfully submit, our only choice is to fight.
We didn't want in any way to be accused of trying to recreate the cast of the old series. But at the same time, we wanted to maintain the family flavor that existed amongst the original cast. Obviously, the Kirk-Spock relationship would be the easiest one to have people say that we were trying to duplicate. For that reason, we stayed away from Vulcans. For that reason, we, in a sense, broke the role of the captain into two parts.
I'm not a family man, Riker, and yet Starfleet has given me a ship with children aboard. But since a captain needs an image of geniality, you're to see that's what I project.
Aye, sir.
Welcome to the Enterprise, Commander Riker.
Marina Sirtis.
It's coming in now.
Is another member of the cast who is also British. She plays Deanna Troy, the ship's counselor.
She's half betazoid from the planet Beta Z and half human. Her mother's a betazoid and her father was a Starfleet officer. And on Beta Z, everyone has this super duper high intelligence. So I'm hugely intelligent. I'm hugely intelligent, and betazoids have telepathic abilities. The full betazoids have a full telepathic ability. I have an ability to read emotions.
The role of Deanna Troy, however, was originally slated for Denise Crosby.
Gene felt that, now these are his words, that I was too much like Grace Kelly. And that that Troy should be this exotic, otherworldly creature. And I was just this kind of American golden girl.
Off camera, Academy Award winner Michael Westmore, one of Hollywood's most respected makeup artists, creates the masks for the aliens we'll see on the show.
The writer will basically give you his first concept of what he wants in the show. Then myself, Gene Roddenberry, Bob Justman, Rick Berman, the art department, we'll all sit down and put our thoughts together to create a character, and then I have to design it so it works.
I'm a Klingon, sir. For me to seek escape when my captain goes into battle...
You are a Starfleet officer, Lieutenant.
Aye, sir.
Industrial Light and Magic, George Lucas's special effects company, has been hired to give the series a real 24th century look.
We're involved, of course, in the traditional outer space kind of shots that are certainly a big part of Star Trek, and those shots will be fairly obvious as being special effects shots. In addition to that, there's some business with some creatures of some kind, and then, as I say, these establishing shots and wider shots of the general planet surface. So it's really very similar to the kinds of special effects shots that appeared in the original series.
This is science fiction in a very believable format, I think.
I'm thrilled about it. I'm thrilled every day that I'm involved in it, and it still seems really quite unreal to me.
Star Trek, The Next Generation. For Patrick Stewart, best known for his success in the British theater, the role of Captain Jean-Luc Picard is not unlike many of the characters he's played in some of Shakespeare's famous plays.
All of this seems perfectly natural to me. Sitting in this chair, which is the command chair and the battle bridge of the USS Enterprise, it's not actually unlike sitting in a throne or a cabinet chair. And a lot of the decision-making that goes on is very, very similar. And in that sense, the kind of work that I've done is being very much continued by this. Equally, the mythic nature of Star Trek as well is all very much a part of work that I've done before. So if you do King Lear, you're standing in a long line of actors who've done it all before you for 400 years or more, so I feel somewhat like that about it. That's why I feel no sense of competition.
I recognize this court system as the one that agreed with that line from Shakespeare. Kill all the lawyers.
Which was done.
Leading to the rule, guilty until proven innocent.
Of course. Bringing the innocent to trial would be unfair. You will now answer to the charge of being a grievously savage race.
Grievously savage could mean anything. I will answer only specific charges.
Patrick became a Star Trek fan many years ago while working as an actor at the Royal Shakespeare Company.
My first encounter with Star Trek was during one of those first seasons at Stratford. I'd rented a cottage several miles out in the country. And my wife, who had been away on tour, used to get home on Saturdays, and I would scuttle back after a matinee of Henry the Fourth, Part One, or Hamlet, or whatever we were doing. And we would have toast and marmalade and tea and Star Trek. It aired about 6 o'clock, I think, in the afternoon. And then I would go back in the evening to do whatever Shakespeare was lined up for us that night. And it became a kind of wonderful diversion in the middle of the day.
Patrick Stewart stars as Captain Jean-Luc Picard in Star Trek: The Next Generation. After many years in television, Jonathan Frakes gets to play a hero as Commander William Riker in Star Trek: The Next Generation.
I've been playing a lot of sleazy characters before this, it seems. Browbeaten, henpecked, or drug dealers, or pimps, oddly enough. And it's, this is a classic, heroic leading man. And it's good fun.
Isn't it a little presumptuous of a first officer to second guess his captain's judgment?
Permission to speak candidly, sir.
Always.
Having been a first officer yourself, you know that assuming that responsibility must, by definition, include the safety of the captain. I have no problem with following any rules you lay down, short of compromising your safety.
Welcome to the Enterprise, Commander Riker.
It's too soon to tell yet whether the relationship between Riker and Counselor Troy will develop.
Have the two of you met before?
We have, sir.
Excellent.
Like the rest of the Star Trek cast, Jonathan is enjoying his involvement on the series.
To a long and successful voyage, the new crew of the Enterprise.
Live long and prosper.
Frakes is very happy to be here, and Riker is very happy to be on board. And I think that that crossover serves both of us.
He just hopes the old Star Trek fans will feel the way he does.
I'm hoping that we'll be taken into the fold. We've had, I must say, very positive response. We received letters already welcoming us to the Star Trek family, as it were. And I'm under the impression that by virtue of being Star Trek fans, they are for the future and for progress. And this certainly is an expression of that. And I hope that we will be received accordingly and not judged as trying to replace someone, because we're really not. I mean, it's a totally new story in a new time.
Jonathan Frakes stars as Commander William Riker in Star Trek: The Next Generation. Best known for his roles in the miniseries Roots and the TV movie Dummy, LeVar Burton finds playing the character of the blind Lieutenant Geordi LaForge in Star Trek: The Next Generation somewhat of a unique challenge.
He's living in a time so different, so vastly different than all of the characters I've ever played before. I mean, he's living actually physically in a time where he doesn't have to deal with a lot of the issues that most of the characters that I've dealt with, I mean, Kunta and Donald Lang as dummy, Ron LaFleur in the Ron LaFleur story, all of these characters have come from uniquely the black experience at different stages in the evolution of America. And in the 24th century, that issue no longer exists.
LeVar's character, Jordy, sees through the use of a visor, a visual input sensory optical reflector, which he wears over his eyes.
Through the use of the visor, this visual input sensory optical reflector, he sees far better than anybody else. Everyone else around him is really blind by comparison because he sees in so much more detail.
These tunnel walls are something I've never seen before, sir.
How are you examining them, Jordy?
In every way, microscopically, thermally, electromagnetically, none of it is familiar.
LeVar Burton stars as Lieutenant Jordy LaForge in Star Trek: The Next Generation. Denise Crosby stars as Security Chief Tasha Yar in Star Trek: The Next Generation.
Hostile is now beginning to overtake us, sir.
This wasn't the role she auditioned for originally.
Marina had auditioned for Tasha, and I was auditioning for Troy at that point. I think we had three callbacks. From what I understand from the producers is that they were sold on me as that part. Gene felt that, now these are his words, that I was too much like Grace Kelly and that I couldn't, that Troy should be this exotic, otherworldly creature, and I was just this kind of American golden girl.
Denise, the granddaughter of the late Bing Crosby, likes the role of Tasha and somehow relates to her character's insecurities, having grown up in an atypical background herself.
Tasha, no!
I must, because I grew up in a world that allowed things like this court, and it was people like these that saved me from it. This so-called court should get down on its knees to what Starfleet is, what it represents.
Denise Crosby stars as Security Chief Tasha Yar in Star Trek: The Next Generation. This is the Michael Dorn TV audiences will see every week on Star Trek: The Next Generation. But before he spends 2 hours in Michael Westmore's makeup chair, making the transition from human to Klingon Lieutenant Worf, you wouldn't look twice if you passed him on the street.
I met Michael Westmore when I was doing the first Rocky. He was doing the makeup for Sylvester Stallone and Carl Weathers, and we had met then. Spent a little time together, but it was a welcome surprise to know that I was going to be working with him again. As you can see by the makeup, it's, you know, he does a fantastic job.
I'm a Klingon, sir. For me to seek escape when my captain goes into battle.
You are a Starfleet officer, Lieutenant.
Aye, sir.
Having spent most of his acting career playing a cop or good guys, Michael finds the Klingon character a welcome change.
I've always played cops and nice guys and lawyers and doctors and boyfriends, but nice people, you know, helpful, you know, and yes, sir, I'll get on that right away. And, you know, this guy is a total departure from anything I've ever done. And so it's a major challenge. I feel I'm doing a good job at it, but it is just, I love a challenge. And he is totally different.
Sick Bay reports Lieutenant Torres' condition is better.
Oh, concern for one's fellow comrade. How touching.
And now a personal request, sir. Permission to clean up the bridge.
It's hard to tell what people are thinking when they choose a character like a Klingon. When they hired him, I think it was just basically to see how it would turn out. But once they saw him on film and they saw how I was portraying him, they probably discovered that, boy, that character is wide open. You know, he can do just about anything. And his presence is felt immediately. Immediately you're drawn to the size, you're drawn to the makeup, you know, the whole nine yards.
Michael Dorn stars as Lieutenant Worf in Star Trek: The Next Generation. As Chief Medical Officer Dr. Beverly Crusher, Star Trek: The Next Generation is Gates McFadden's initiation into episodic television. She finds it quite different from anything she's done in the theater or motion pictures.
It's different because you're constantly getting a new script. You don't have the time to rehearse that you would in a theater situation.
Medical team's already preparing to beam down, Captain.
This is my first go at episodic television, really, so I'm learning on my feet about how one develops a character. I'm much more used to getting a text, and it's not something that keeps continuing. Every new week you have a new episode. But it's fun. I like it that way.
Maybe this is something Jean-Luc would like looked into.
Jean-Luc Picard? You know the captain.
When I was little, he brought my father's body home to us.
Yes, Wes, long, long ago. A pleasure to meet you, Commander. Will excuse us.
My pleasure, Doctor.
While it's been a transition for Gates, she does, however, find many welcome similarities.
Okay, it's like being pleasant
with them. You sort of have a feeling of being with a family, which one does when you do theater as well, or you work on any sort of, even working on a film, you get very close to the people that you're working with. So I'm very pleased that it's at Paramount, because it sort of seems like a lovely atmosphere around here. So that's nice.
For you too. Work with a commanding officer who would continually remind you of a terrible personal tragedy.
My feelings about my husband's death will have no effect on the way I serve you, this vessel, or this mission.
Ah. Then, welcome aboard, Doctor. I hope we can be friends.
Gates McFadden stars as Chief Medical Officer Dr. Beverly Crusher in Star Trek: The Next Generation. For British actress Marina Sirtis, getting the role of Deanna Troi in Star Trek: The Next Generation was something she'd only dreamed of back in London.
It's like I'm living the Hollywood fairy tale dream. 6 months ago, I was working in a store, you know, earning like kind of $5 an hour. And now, it's unreal. I can't believe it. I'm like this every day, like pinching myself every morning.
I'm puzzled over you bringing a Betazoid to this meeting. If her purpose, sir, is to probe my thoughts...
I can sense only strong emotions, Grappler. I'm only half Betazoid. My father was a Starfleet officer.
What's all this?
If the telephone call from the casting department had come a couple of hours later, Marina would have missed her big chance.
My visa was running out, and so I decided to go home for a while, renew my visa, and see my family and everything. And I'd been auditioning for 6 weeks, 7 weeks, I don't know. So I'd done my final audition, and I was leaving on the Wednesday, I think. And they called and said, well, we'll let you know Thursday if you've got the job. On Monday, this game's very confusing. And I said, well, I'm sorry, I can't. I have a ticket back to England. I'm going to use it. I'm going back. So I was packing on Wednesday morning to leave, and at lunchtime I was kind of, you know, closing the suitcases and wiping away the tears and thinking, oh God, I've blown it, it's gone. And the phone rang and I got the job. So I cancelled my ticket and stayed.
Commander Riker, this is our ship's counselor, Deanna Troi.
A pleasure, Commander.
Likewise, Counselor.
Have the two of you met before?
We have, sir.
Excellent.
Stop me, if I grin too much, it's just because, you know, I just can't wipe the grin off my face. And we're 10 weeks into it. I mean, it's just amazing.
Marina Sirtis stars as Counselor Deanna Troi in Star Trek: The Next Generation. Born after the original series went off the air, Wil Wheaton, the youngest member of the cast of Star Trek: The Next Generation, considers himself without a doubt to be a fan.
I'm a Trekkie, but not the kind of Trekkie that knows everything about the show. I couldn't tell you, like, who starred in episode number 13, you know, in the second half, who was the main focus or anything like that. What I do is I love to read the books. The novels I haven't really gotten into yet, but, like, the comic book I read, the old series I watch every night, unless I have to get up real, real early for work the next day.
Will plays Wes Crusher, Dr. Beverly Crusher's brilliant 15-year-old son.
Mom, could you get me a look at the bridge?
That's against the captain's standing orders.
Are you afraid of the captain, too?
I certainly am not.
The panel on your right is for log entries, library computer access and retrieval, view screen control, and intercom and so on. Here we have...
On here, the backup con and ops panels, plus shield and armament controls.
Forward view screen is controlled from the ops position there.
Which uses high-resolution multi-spectral imaging sensor systems.
How the hell do you know that, boy?
Alert!
Perimeter alert, Captain.
Leslie!
I'm sorry.
Wes, you shouldn't have touched
me. Get off the bridge. Don't come here!
You have a perimeter alert, sir.
As my son tried to tell you.
His respect for Captain Jean-Luc Picard is also evident off-camera for the actor who plays the role.
Patrick, I really want to impress. I really want, you know, to show him that, you know, I can do good. I don't know why, just because I think I look up to him because he's such an incredible actor and because he's the captain. Wesley, really, I think, you know, in some of his wildest dreams, really wants to command a Starfleet vessel. And so he looks up to Captain Picard in that respect.
Will really loves working on the series and enjoys the way the rest of the cast treats him.
They treat me not like a kid, but as an equal, which I really appreciate and I really like. You know, it's the same way the character isn't treated. The character isn't treated as a child, treated as an equal. And they're not condescending or rude or anything like that to me because I'm a kid. They treat me the way they would treat anybody else, which is really rad.
Wil Wheaton stars as Wes Crusher in Star Trek: The Next Generation. No television series can claim the legendary fame of Star Trek. Today it can be seen in over 100 domestic markets and in over 40 countries worldwide. All this because of one man's vision. And Gene Roddenberry intends to continue the tradition in Star Trek: The Next Generation.
The way Paramount interested me in this one, they said it's impossible to do again, at which point my ears perked up.
As in the original series, Gene's aim is to produce stories that, while they entertain, will offer positive human messages that are relevant to today's issues.
When the captain suggested you, I looked up your record.
Yes, sir. A wise procedure, sir, always.
Then your rank of lieutenant commander is honorary.
No, sir. Starfleet class of 78, honors in probability mechanics and exobiology.
But your file says you're a...
machine, correct, sir. Does that trouble you?
To be honest, yes, a little.
Understood, sir. Prejudice is very human.
Now, that does trouble me. Do you consider yourself superior to us?
I am superior, sir, in many ways. But I would gladly give it up to be human.
There are a lot of issues and challenges in the 80s and 90s and the end of the century that need talking about. And they need talking about in drama because drama will move people, will cause people to think and... much more than any straight show.
As a first-run syndicated series, Star Trek: The Next Generation will be exempt from the restrictions usually placed on shows by the television networks, relieving a lot of problems for executive producer Gene Roddenberry.
Last show, there were so many niddling things we had to worry about. We had a network that said you cannot have half men and half women because there will be a lot of escapades going on in the ship. We fought them off when they said, you've got to have chaplains and American flags around. And we're saying, hey, this is hundreds of years from now, but we'll not face that. And yeah, we'll have much more freedom.
One of the two supervising producers on Star Trek: The Next Generation is Robert Justman. He was also the co-producer on the original series.
It's a more complicated show today. The state of the art with respect to opticals and effects,
We progressed so far from those primitive days that we certainly can't get by doing the sort of things we used to do before. Insofar as the drama of the various pieces go, I don't think there's very much difference at all, except for the fact that we do have a larger cast now, and we have different characters playing different roles.
This is a court of the year 2079, by which time more rapid progress had caused all United Earth nonsense to be abolished.
Natasha, no!
I must, because I grew up in a world that allowed things like this court, and it was people like these that saved me from it. This so-called court should get down on its knees to what Starfleet is, what it represents.
Although Robert has served in various capacities on more than 55 motion pictures and at least 500 television shows, Star Trek is by far his favorite project.
It's truly marvelous. Remember, I've known Gene since about 1964. We worked together on the first Star Trek pilot and the second Star Trek pilot and the series. It's like I went home one night in 1968 and came back to work the next morning in 1986. That's what it's like. It's like time passed in a wink of an eye and nothing has changed, and the feeling between us has only grown. We're closer and more emotionally bound to each other than we ever were. And so it's a wonderful feeling.
Robert would like everyone, including the original Trekkies, to get that feeling when they see the new series.
The Trekkies loved the original cast and cared for each one of them very much and felt, in a way, slightly betrayed by the fact that they wouldn't be coming back. But Trekkies are forward-looking people. And once you get over that initial dismay, you start thinking about, well, what is the new one going to be like?
Stand by.
Ready for departure, sir.
Engage. We have a long voyage ahead of us.
For Rick Berman, one of the two supervising producers on Star Trek: The Next Generation, the casting for the series was one of the most important facets of pre-production.
I think the nine actors that we've put together are just remarkable. They work together like a family, even though they've only been together a few months. Every director we have used to date, including people who've worked on ensemble shows like L.A. Law, St. Elsewhere, Hill Street Blues, say they've never seen an ensemble of actors who work, who are not only as professional as ours are, but who work so beautifully together. And when you're dealing with an ensemble show, whether it takes place in a lawyer's office in the 20th century or on a starship in the 24th century, the relationship and the access these people have to each other's lives and emotions is what makes the shows work. And that's what we're hoping we have found with this complement of actors.
Lieutenant, inform engine room to prepare for maximum acceleration.
Aye, sir.
Record search data. Results of detaching saucer section at high warp velocity.
Inadvisable at any warp speed, sir.
Search theoretical.
It is possible, but absolutely no margin for error.
Using printout only, notify all decks to prepare for maximum acceleration.
With a good cast and Gene Roddenberry at the helm, Rick feels that the new series has all the ingredients to follow in the footsteps of the original series.
I think the only way this show can work, and I think the reason it is going to work, is because of Gene Roddenberry. Gene is Star Trek to the hardcore followers, to the people who have been watching the show in syndication, to the people who watched the show originally. This show represents a vision that Gene has, not only of the 24th or 23rd or century, but a vision of life and of how people deal with the human condition. To do Star Trek without Gene Roddenberry is doing something without a license. And I think it's essential that Gene has to be part of it. And to our delight, he has been more than just the titular head. Gene has been, you know, actively involved in every aspect of pre-production and production. and he has been the head writer, and in fact has written and polished every script to date. It's wonderful to see him after 15 years of being away from the old show, of getting right back into dealing with things just on the edge of what most people would consider as acceptable television.
For the last 70 years, the Westmore family has dominated the field of Hollywood makeup. In all that time, Michael Westmore has been the only one to win an Academy Award, but that's probably because Oscars weren't given out for this category until 1981. He won the award for the critically acclaimed movie Mask.
I've had the opportunity to win a lot of awards in makeup. My wife claims I'll work for chocolate chip cookies, and it seems the creativity in the work is really more important to me than the actual dollars to it. The excitement of turning clay and plaster into reality. I'm really not into creating monsters. I like to create characters and fantasy, and such in Star Trek with the aliens and things, because you see a person come alive as opposed to something that's large and mechanical.
Awards are not given out for early morning calls, however. But when Michael Dorn is shooting, Westmore arrives at the studio at least an hour and a half before the rest of the cast and crew, which is sometimes before the sun comes up.
Michael Dorn is a Klingon. The first time we did him took about 2.5 hours. Now we've got the makeup down to about an hour and a half, and that's putting his head on, putting his nose on, getting his hair all combed and styled, putting his beard and his mustache on, and then going and getting dressed and getting on the set. So you're able to reduce the time once you get your routine down. There's things that have been roaming around in my mind that I would like to do, but there's never any time to do them creatively in makeup. And Star Trek has given me that opportunity to be creative.
As production designer for Star Trek, The Next Generation, Herman Zimmerman is responsible for everything visual on the series.
Well, I get about 2 weeks' notice on a script. I get about 10 working days to do the thinking, do the drawing, get the sets constructed and ready to shoot.
It was his department that created Geordi LaForge's optical reflector.
As a matter of fact, what he's wearing now was the last minute thing. We'd worked on it for probably 2.5 or 3 months, and nothing that we came up with was right. And what you see on Geordi now is a reproduction of a plastic barrette. A barrette that generally fits over a woman's head like this. Michael Kuda came in with that one day, said my girlfriend was putting this in her hair the other day. I thought, wow, wouldn't that look good over Geordi's eyes? And we went out and bought some, and we remanufactured one of our basic ideas using that as the basis.
Herman enjoys the challenge of designing a futuristic look, as there's no one around to doubt its authenticity.
I think it's more fun to do science fiction than do history. Your research is pretty much cut and dried. When you're dealing with the future, the sky's the limit. You extrapolate from what the most modern architects are that you can deal with now in your century, and you read what you know of people like H.G. Wells, people that have, Jules Verne, people that have prognosticated into the future. And of course now we have all the Raiders of the Lost Ark and Star Wars motion pictures and the Star Trek motion pictures to compete with. So we can't make the broad statements that the early series did and get away with it. We have to be very much more scientifically accurate.
Industrial Light and Magic, George Lucas's special effects company, is currently at work producing the visual special effects for Star Trek, The Next Generation. Visual effects that 20 years ago didn't exist when the original series aired.
We like to feel that we have, over the years, put together the best crew of people that is available. I think it would be going a bit far to say that there's no other place anything like this anywhere in the world that covers a lot of territory. But I think the unique combination of the experience here and the people that are here makes it the best place to come.
A leader in its field, ILM, as it's referred to in the entertainment community, has won 7 Academy Awards for its work on some of the biggest box office movies in the last 10 years. They previously produced the visual effects for 3 of the Star Trek films.
Normally on a feature, we would have anywhere from 2-3 months just to do pre-production art and to plan the shots, to talk with the director about what the nature of the work's going to be, what the look wants to be. As I say, 2 or 3 months we would like to have that on a feature. In this case, we were still talking with Paramount the week before we began the project on just what work we would get, and it was literally less than a week that we had to prepare how we were going to do all this before we began shooting.
Star Trek: The Next Generation will be ILM's initiation into the world of series television, where just a couple of years ago, effects like these would have been totally out of the question for any television budget. Now, ILM makes it a reality.